Welcome to PharmaGuy, and today we will start the topic manufacturing of tablets, and we will study area required for manufacturing of tablets, steps involved in manufacturing of tablets, tablets manufacturing equipment and machines in short, and then pulverization and mixing in detail, and then granulation and mechanism of granulation in detail. Okay, now area required for manufacturing of tablets. First, you can see in this figure is the receiving area. Second is the receiving quarantine. Third is the approved raw material. Fourth is dispensary. Fifth is mixing, granulation and drying. Number six is tablet punching section, then coating section, then comes the quality control section, then in process quarantine, and then 10th number is approved final products. Then these products go to packaging section and then to the shipping. Steps involved in manufacturing of tablets. First is dispensing. Each ingredient in the tablet formula is weighed and dispensed accurately as per dose. Second, sizing. Formulation ingredients must be in fine powder form. Otherwise, size reduction should be carried out for better flow property and easy mixing. Third is powder blending. Powders are mixed using a suitable blender to obtain a uniform and homogeneous powder mix. The drug substance and excipients are mixed in geometric dilution. Fourth step is granulation. To increase the free flowing properties, powder particles are gathered together into layers and permanent aggregates. These are called granules. Step 5 is drying and dry screening. Screened wet granules are dried for a particular time period in tray dryer or fluid bed dryer at a controlled temperature not exceeding 55 degrees Celsius. Dried granules are screened through appropriate mesh screen. Step 6 is tablet compression. This step involves the compression of granules into flat or convex, round, oblong or unique shaped tablets engraved with an identifying symbol and or code number using the tablet press. 7th step is coating. Tablets and granules are coated if there is need to mask the unpleasant taste or odor of some drugs or to increase the aesthetic appeal of uncoated tablets, as well as to modify the release or control the release of drug substance from tablets. This is attained by enclosing or covering the core tablet or granules with the coating solutions. Okay, tablet manufacturing equipment and machines. First is size reduction equipment. We'll study in short here. Size reduction equipments, example, hammer mill, vibration mill, roller mill, pin mill, fluidized energy mill, end runner mill, edge runner mill, cutter mill and ball mill. Okay, next is the weighing balances. Electronic weighing balance for weighing in grams and milligrams, and bulk weighing balance for weighing in kilograms. Mixing equipments like pneumatic mixers, air drive mixer, diffusion or tumbling mixers, V blender, double cone blender, cubic mixer, drum blender, convective mixers like ribbon blender, orbiting screw mixer, horizontal high intensity blenders, planetary blenders, diffusion mixer with intensifier, bar or agitator, horizontal double arm mixer, vertical high intensity mixers, granulators like rotating shape granulator, mechanical agitator granulators, example, ribbon or paddle blender, sigma blade mixer, planetary mixer, orbiting screw mixer, high shear granulator, fluidized bed granulator or dry granulator. In this video, we will study these size reduction equipment and mixing equipments in detail. Drying equipment like spray dryer, rotary dryer, fluidized bed dryer, tableting machine, single punch tablet press and multi-station rotary tablet press. Example, high speed rotary tablet machines and multi-layer rotary tablet machines. Quality control equipments, disintegration equipment, dissolution tester, tablet hardness tester, thickness tester, friability tester, I already discussed in my last video. Coating and polishing machine for coating coated tablets, example, standard coating pan, perforated pan, fluidized bed, air suspension, coating system, etc. Packaging machines like blister packaging machine, strip packaging machine, aluminum foil packaging machines, etc. So these were in short. In a manufacturing of tablets. Manufacturing of tablets involves certain well-defined steps, namely pulverization and mixing, then granulation, then compression, and then coating. Okay, now pulverization. In this step, the different solid and powder ingredients are reduced to the same particle size. Okay, since the particle size of different size will segregate while mixing. So all the powders and solid ingredients, they have to be of the same particle size, otherwise they will segregate while mixing. size reduction process is also termed as comminution or diminution or pulverization. Size reduction may be achieved by two methods, precipitation process and mechanical process. In precipitation process, first the substance is dissolved in one solvent, then other solvent is added. The other solvent will be miscible with the first solvent, but the substance will precipitate. Substance is dissolved in an appropriate solvent. Subsequently, it is precipitated by addition of another solvent, which is miscible with the first, but in the later substance is insoluble. This method is suitable for the production of raw materials and bulk drugs. Mechanical process. The substance is subject to mechanical force using the grinding equipment. For example, ball mill, roller mill, colloid mill. Dry grinding or milling is used in the production of tablets and capsules, and wet grinding is used in the preparation of suspensions, emulsions and fine paints. Okay, now these are the different type of forces that are applied during the size reduction process: compressive, frictional, impact, shearing, collision force. What mechanism of size reduction? First is cutting. Material is cut by the means of sharp blade, for example in cutter mill. Compression, in this mode material is crushed between the roller by the application of pressure, for example in roller mill. Impact, this involves the operation of hammers and bars at high speed, for example hammer mill. Attrition, breaking down by the rubbing action between the two surface or the particles, for example fluid energy mill. Now comminution equipments. There are many types of large-scale comminution equipment available in the pharmaceutical industry, which can be classified into three categories based on the feed and size in the machine. Coarse crushers, for example jaw, gyratory, roll and impact crushers with feed material ranging from 1.5 to 60 inches. Then intermediate grinders, rotary cutter, disc, hammer roller, chaser mill with the produce provide between 20 and 200 mesh. Third is a fine grinding mill, for example ball, rod, hammer, colloid, fluid energy mill, high speed mechanical screen, centrifugal classifier, in which the particle can pass through 200 mesh. Classification and characteristic of size reduction equipments: cutter mill, cutting machine, impact mill or hammer mill, rolling compression, roller mill, attrition mill, tumbling mill, these are grinders. Okay, impact mill used almost for all kind of drugs. Rolling compression or roller mill is used for the soft material. Attrition mill and tumbling mill almost for all kind of drugs and brittle drugs. Okay, fluid energy mill, this is ultra fine grinder, moderately hard and friable materials can be reduced in size. Edge runner mill and end runner mill, these are rushers used for the mainly soft materials. Instruments used for milling or sizing. First is the hammer mill. You can see in this figure there are four hammers, rotating shaft attached to the rotating shaft and the sieve. Hammer mill, this is the intermediate grinding mill. It consists of the hammers placed on the rotating shaft. Now when the feed enters the machine, rapid moving hammers, these impact the solid material and break it down into the relatively smaller particles. So this is the mechanism of hammer mill. Second is the triple roller mill or roller mill. Okay, these are crushers composed of rotating cylinders on the horizontal shaft driving in the opposite directions. Okay, distance between these cylinders can be adjusted to achieve the desired particle size. Third is the laboratory scale batch operation ball mill. Okay, this is also a fine grinding mill. Okay, there is a horizontal cylinder, you can see in the figure. Cylinder, this contains the balls that occupy almost 30 to 50% of the total volume of the cylinder. Okay, now these balls are of different sizes. Balls have different size so that the void gap between the balls is reduced. Okay, there are bigger balls, smaller balls. Bigger balls will create some void space which will be covered by the small balls. Okay, so large balls will break the solid pieces and small balls will break these pieces into even fines. Okay, it works on the principle of both impact and attrition. Next is the colloid mill. Colloid mill is used in the disintegration of the solid particles or the droplet size of the liquid in suspensions or emulsions. Okay, in this shearing takes place in the narrow gap between the static cone, that is the stator, and a rapidly moving cone, that is the rotor. Now, fifth one is the fluid energy mill. Okay, this is also referred to as jet mill. It contains a hollow housing having a diameter of 20 to 200 centimeter. Now a fluid, usually air, it is injected into the loop at very high pressure, which forms the turbulence zone. You can see the turbulence zone is produced downwards. When the feed passes through this turbulence zone, impaction of the particle to particle is achieved. Okay, and size reduction occurs based on the impaction and attrition. Okay, now the centrifugal action throw the coarser particles outwards, and this classifier will remove the fine particles and the fluid. That is, fluid is the air. Okay, here's a table. This will show you principal construction, working, use, advantage and disadvantage of the various mills. First is the rotary cutter mill. Work on the principle of cutting. Consists of various knives which rotate at 200 to 900 RPM, and the fines are produced between 80 to 100 mesh. It is not suitable for the friable material. Next is the roller mill. Work on the principle of stress and attrition. Okay, two rollers, they rotate longitudinally. Okay, crushing occurs between the rollers. Crushing of the seeds for extraction. It is mainly used for the crushing of seeds for extraction, not used for the abrasive material. Ball mill, both impact and attrition, a hollow cylinder which occupies 30 to 50% of space. Drug is occupy up to 60% of the volume. Speed of rotation is important. Okay, it can grind brittle drugs to fine powders, and particle size of 100 to 5 millimeter or less can be achieved. Okay, advantage is good. Toxic, it can be used for the size reduction of toxic and sterile substances, but it is very noisy. Hammer mill works on the principle of impact. Hammers present either sharp or flat edges, with the sharp or flat edges, and they rotate at 8000 to 15000 RPM. It is used for the grinding dry materials, wet filter cakes, ointments, and particle size of 10 to 400 millimeter can be achieved. Operation in the closed system, easy to set up and scale up, and screen may get clogged. This is the disadvantage. Okay, next is the fluid energy mill, which works on the principle of impact and attrition. There are 2 to 6 grinding nozzles, and air at 600 kilopascal to 1 megapascal is introduced. Due to high degree of turbulence, impact and attrition occurs between the particles. Used for the moderately hardened friable material, and particles can be reduced up to size 1 to 200 microns. Not used for the soft and sticky material. Colloid mill works on the principle of shearing. Construction, it consists of a rotor and a stator disc, okay, which rotates at 3000 rotor disc rotates at the speed of 3000 to 20000 rpm, and distance between these two discs can be maintained between 0.001 inch to 0.005 inch. okay, used in the preparation of ointment, cream, gels, suspensions, mainly used in the preparation of suspensions. Okay, rapid handling and easy cleaning, cannot be used for thermolabile substances. Edge runner mill, crushing and shearing is the principle. Rollers are made up of stones. Rollers have shaft and they rotate on its own axis. Grinding of the plant-based products is mainly done in the edge runner mill. Okay, less attention during the operation, not used for the sticky material. Okay, end runner mill, crushing and works on the same principle. Crushing and shearing, it consists of a mechanical motor and pestle. Motor revolves at a high speed, suitable for fine grinding, and drugs which are unbroken, it cannot be used for the drugs which are unbroken. Now blenders, first is the ribbon blender. It consists of a U-shaped horizontal trough and an agitator made up of inner and outer helical ribbons. You can see in the figure, the outer and inner helical ribbons, these are mounted on a drive shaft through the long axis of the trough, and it moves the material axially in the opposite direction as well as radially. Mechanism of mixing is shear, and the ribbon blenders are used for the mixing of wet solid mass and liquid solid mixing. Now next is the tumble blender. Tumbling mixer are commonly used for the mixing of granules and free flowing powders. For example, Dubban cone mixer, twin shell mixer, cube mixer. Shear mixing will occur when velocity gradient is produced. Or mechanism of mixing is shear, and the if additional addition of waffles or rotating bars will also cause the convective mixing. A common use of tumbling mixer is blending of lubricants, glidants and external disintegrants with the granules prior to tableting. Vertical blenders, you can see in the figure, there is a screw or a auger screw that orbits a conical vessel wall. While it turns, it moves the or lifts the material upwards. As the material reach the uppermost level of the batch, they cascade or the material cascade slowly back down in the region opposite the moving auger screw. Material is lifted by the auger screw from downwards to upwards, and when the material which reach the top level, it will again go back, go downwards. A common use of the vertical blender is vacuum drying, where the starting material is in the form of wet granules or even a slurry, and the end product is typically a free-flowing powder. Requiring only low heat to drive off the moisture or solvents, vacuum drying is an excellent method for drying heat-sensitive pharmaceutical products without the fear of thermal degradation. Now, techniques, methods used in the tablet formulation. Tablets are commonly manufactured by wet granulation, dry granulation, or direct compression. Now, granulation is the process in which powder particles are made to adhere to form a larger particle, and these larger particles are called granules. Pharmaceutical granules typically have a size range between 0.2 to 4 millimeter, depending on their subsequent use. Now, simple powder may not have the desired flow properties because there are many type of forces acting between the solid particles. Therefore, formation of granules is important to improve the flow properties of the powders. What are the forces that act between the solid particles? The frictional forces, surface tension force, mechanical force caused by interlocking of the particle of irregular shape, electrostatic force, and cohesive or van der Waal forces. So simple powder may not have the desired flow properties because of these forces. So formation of granules is important. Though bulk density and shape of the particles, these are the important characteristics, but two most important experiments tend to have some idea about the flow property of the powders are angle of repose and Hopper flow rate measurement. Now, if the angle of repose or value for angle of repose is less than 30 degree, it indicates the free flowing material. So, if the value of angle of repose is less than 30 degree, indicates free flowing material, and if the more than 40 degree, suggests a poorly flowing material. Hopper flow rate measurement have been used as a method to assess flowability of the powder mass. How? In this method, the flow of the powder from a conical hopper is continually monitored by flow of the material out of the hopper onto a recording weighing balance. The material intended for compaction into tablet, it must possess two important characteristics, that is fluidity and compressibility. Good flow properties are essential for transport of material through the hopper into and through the feed frame into the dies. Okay, tablet material should therefore be in the physical form that flows uniformly and smoothly. Ideal physical form is a sphere, since the sphere offers minimum contact surface between themselves and with the wall of the machine parts. Unfortunately, most materials do not easily form a sphere. However, shape approaching spheres improve the flowability of the powder. Hence, flow property of the powder material is improved by forming sphere-like regular shaped aggregates. These are called granules. Okay, now aim of granulation can be, or objective of granulation can be, to compress powders to reduce the loss of powder and to improve the dosing, to avoid separation and adhesion of powder mixture, to improve the compressibility of material, to form high dose active substance into granules, to improve the flowability of material, to prepare controlled drug delivery particles, example, delayed dissolution sustained drug delivery, and fast absorbing drug delivery system, for example, effervescent granules. Now, mechanisms of granulation. At granulation, binding excipients should be used, while immobile layer developed due to granulating solution containing binding material and having a high viscosity can create a stronger binding. At granulation, binding excipients should be used. These binding excipients are dissolved in the granulating solution. It forms a viscous liquid, and this viscous liquid forms an immobile layer around the particles. And this immobile layer between the particle and particle, it will lead to a, or it will create a stronger bonding or binding. Particle bonding mechanisms. During granulation, solid bridges between the particles are created by many mechanisms like partial melting. These solid bridges between the particles created by partial melting or partial dissolution of the moisture material or with the binding materials. Okay, these particle bonding mechanisms can also be we can say of five types. Primary bindings are distinguished into the following types. First is adhesion and cohesion forces in the immobile liquid film created between the primary powder particles. This immobile liquid with layer which is created around the particles will have some adhesion and cohesion forces. If the sufficient liquid is present in a powder to form a very thin layer, immobile layer, there will be an effective decrease in the interparticular distance and increase in the contact area between the particles, and this will lead to stronger bonding. The bond strength between the particles will be increased because of this. Okay, now second is interfacial forces in the mobile liquid film within the granule. When the liquid is added to the powders, this will form the immobile layer around the particles, and there will be some interfacial forces at the liquid and air interface in the mobile liquid films. During the wet granulation, liquid is added to the powder mix and will distribute it as films around the and between the particles. There are three states of water distribution between the particles. Okay, first is the pendular state. At low moisture levels, termed pendular state, the particles are held together by the lens-shaped rings of the liquid. Okay, liquid bridges are formed between the particles when at the low moisture level. This is termed as pendular state. Okay, these causes adhesion because of surface tension forces of the liquid air interface and hydrostatic suction pressure in the liquid bridges. So two forces are there: surface tension forces at the liquid air interface and hydrostatic suction pressure in the liquid bridge, which is formed between the particles. When all the air has been displaced between the particles, then this will reach to capillary state. Okay, particles are held by the capillary suction at the air liquid interface, which is now only at the granule surface. Between these two, pendular and capillary state, is the funicular state. See in this figure, this is the dry powder. When granulating liquid is added, there are some liquid bridges formed. Okay, this is the pendular state. If more granulating liquid will be added, this will reach to funicular state. And when all the space between the particles is covered with the granulating liquid, this will lead to the capillary state. And capillary state will lead to the suspension if more granulating liquid is added. This is the water distribution between the particles of a granule during formation and drying. Next in particle binding mechanism is formation of solid bridges. Now, during the granulation, the solid bridges between the particles are created by partial melting, partial dissolution of the moistened powder material, or with the binding materials. Okay, there are three procedures or three mechanisms by which the solid bridges can be formed between the particles: by the partial melting, by the partial dissolution of the moistened powder material, or with the binding materials. Now, we'll discuss these three methods. First is the partial melting. Okay, use of excipient with the low melting points, or excipients with the low melting points, are used, and solid bridges are formed by the partial melting of these excipients. Now, between the particles, molten bridges are formed by the heating can be solidified by cooling, and this operation is called sintering, and the granules created with this operation are called the sinter granules. You can see in the figure, first is the molten liquid bridges, second is the bridge solidified by cooling. At dry granulation, in the case of material with low melting point, partial melting can be caused by the applied pressure. At the dry granulation, this partial melting can also be done by applying the pressure instead of heating. When the pressure is relieved, crystallization will take place and bind the particles together. But there is a problem, and attention has to be paid to the fact that if the active ingredient also have low melting point, it will also get molten, and with cross crystallization can precipitate in creation of the bridges. So this will thus the dissolution profile of the active ingredients may get changed. Hardening binders. Solid bridges formed from solidified binding agents are created from the liquid bridges consisted of solution of binding material after drying and solidification or crystallization of the binding material. This binding material is dissolved in the granulating liquid, and the liquid bridges will be formed between the particles And after drying, solidification or crystallization of this binding material will occur. This technique is called the adhesive granulation and is commonly used for the wet granulation of the granules having the high hardness and appropriate mechanical properties. The liquid will form the liquid bridges as discussed above, and the adhesive will harden, adhesive or binder will harden or crystallize on drying to form the solid bridges to bind the particles. You can see in the figure there are four steps. First step is the formation of liquid bridges from the solution of binding material. Second is concentration of the binding material solution bridges by evaporation. Third is becoming a solution to be concentrated, then starting the crystallization of the binding material. And fourth will lead to the solidification of the bridges, form crystals of the binding material by drying. So this is forming of solid bridges from the liquid during adhesive granulation technique. Quantity of binding material has to be determined to produce granules with appropriate hardness, but must not slow the dissolution. According to the publications, exaggerated amount of granulating material result in decelerated liberation of the active ingredient. If more granulating material is used, then it has been shown that there is decrease in the release of the active ingredient. So the quantity of the binding material has to be determined. Adhesives such as polyvinyl pyrrolidone, cellulose derivatives, pre-gelatinized starch, these functions in this way. Okay, now after partial melting and hardening binders, crystallization of dissolved substances. Partial dissolution of moistened powder material can only be counted if at granulation applied moistening solution dissolve one or the more component of the powder material. Okay, now there is no binding agent, only moistening solution is added and some of the component, one or more component of the powder material or the powder particle will dissolve and will form the liquid bridge. After drying of the moistened material, solid bridges are created from the liquid bridges formed from the own material of the particles. These are called the encrusted granules. You can see in this figure there are four steps. First is the creation of liquid bridges from the solution of the own material of the granules. Only the moistening solution is added to the powders and some part of the powder will melt to form the liquid bridges. Evaporation. Second step is evaporation of solvent from the liquid bridges. Third step will lead to the concentration or starting of the crystallization. Fourth is solidification of the bridges done by drying containing the own material of the granules. There is no binding agent. This is the own material of the particle powder particles. Development of concentration condition is significantly determined by the speed of drying, thus the size of the crystals forming the solid bridges. Larger crystals are formed with the slower drying, while the smaller ones are created with the faster drying. Therefore, if the active substance is also dissolved in the applied solvent, then recrystallization depending on the operation parameter also influences the dissolution. Now, here also this is a problem. If the active ingredient is also soluble in the moistening solution, it may change the dissolution profile of the active ingredient and liberation of the active ingredient. Any material soluble in the granulating liquid will function in this manner. For example, lactose incorporated into dry powder granulated with water. Okay, now after the adhesion and cohesion forces, then the interfacial forces and the solid bridges between the particles. Next in the particle binding mechanism is the attraction force between the solid particles. There are two types of attractive forces that can be operated between the particles in the pharmaceutical system. Okay, first is the electrostatic forces. Electrostatic forces may be important in causing the powder cohesion and the initial formation of the agglomerates. For example, during mixing, the electrostatic force is generated, which will keep the particles together. In general, they do not contribute significantly in the final strength of the granules. They only form the initial, only leads to the initial formation of the agglomerates. Next is the van der Waals forces. However, these are four times or four order of magnitude greater than the electrostatic forces, and they contribute significantly to the strength of the granules. Electrostatic force do not contribute in the strength of the granules. They only form the initial agglomerates, and then van der Waals forces contribute significantly to the strength of the granules. The magnitude of these forces will increase as the distance between the adjacent surface decreases, and in the dry granulation this is achieved by using pressure to force the particles together. Fifth is the effect of mechanical connection. Based on the shape of the particles and surface unevenness, due to their shape and the surface unevenness, they are somewhat fitted with one another. Okay, so based on the shape of the particle and surface unevenness, these are also the binding forces without adding excipient creating bridges. However, these are significantly weaker than the solid bridges performed with binding agents. Okay, now granules formation mechanism, nucleation or creation of core. Granulation is performed by adhesion of primer particles by creation of liquid bridges. Primer particles adhere to each other with pedicular funicular state, and then after further stirring with the capillary state, formed cores are the base of the later increase of the granules. Next is the transition state. Following creation of the core or after the creation of core, granulation process can continue with two kind of transformations. Primer particles adhere to each other with the pendular bridges or core adhere to each other. Okay? Either the primary particles adhere to each other or cores adhere to each other. The combined nuclei will be reshaped by the agitation of the bed. This stage is characterized by the presence of large number of small granules with a fairly wide size distribution. Size of the forming particles and proportion of the smaller and larger particles, these are determined by operation parameters. Influence of these parameters can be characterized with average particle size and particle size dispersion. Particles with larger size or too high portion of the powder size, wide particle size dispersion can result in complications during the compression. Okay, such as non-uniform loading into the bed die or in the die cavity. Next is the ball growth or increase in the particle size. Continuation of the granulation leads to increase in the particle size and assist in creation of spherical particles, which is beneficial to produce of pellets. Coalescence of the particles continue due to further stirring or adhesion of the particles continues due to further stirring, which ultimately causes formation of the unusual mass. Development of this over-stirred state depends on the quantity of the granulation liquid and the properties of the applied powder beyond the parameter of the stirring. So stirring time and speed is important because due to over stirring the unusual mass may be formed. Four possible mechanism in of the ball growth are coalescence, two or more granules join together to form larger granule, breakage, granules break into fragments which adhere to the another granules forming a layer of material over the surviving granule, abrasion transfer, agitation of the granule bed leads to the attrition of the material from the granules. This abraded material adheres to the other granules, increasing in the size. Okay, due to the attrition, some of the granules will break, and this abraded material, these adheres to the other granules, so increase in the size. Fourth is the layering. Stratification develops when further powder material is introduced to the granulating equipment during the granulation process. These new particles stratify onto the present granules, which will lead to smoother and more even surface while size is increased. So granules are formed, and after that further fine powder is added, which will these new particles will set over the present granules and will lead to a smoother and more even surface of the granules. This mechanism is beneficial to produce the pellets. Okay, we can see in this figure mechanism of ball growth during the granulation. First step is the coalescence, where two or more granules join together to form the larger granule. Second is the breakage. Okay, granules breaks into the fragments and adhere to the another granule. Third is the abrasion transfer. That is, during the attrition, it leads to a shed of some of the material from the granule, and this abraded material adhere to the another granule. Third is the layering. Further addition of the powder material to the granulation, these new particles stratify onto the present granules and lead to the smoother and more even surface. Okay, used in the in the formation of pellets. Okay, thank you for your time and attention. And my next video will be on the wet granulation. We'll continue this topic. If you like content of my videos, please like them, share them, and please subscribe to my channel Pharma Guide.